Hide thy face from my sins and blot out all mine iniquities. And if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dearly beloved, the scripture moves us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with a humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together, to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying with me, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts, and we have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and have given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at last we may come to his eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. O Lord, open thou our lips, and our mouth shall show forth thy praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Praise ye the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and show ourselves glad in him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands prepared the dry land. O come, let us worship and fall down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts, as in the provocation and as in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me and saw my works. 40 years long was I grieved with this generation, and said, It is a people that do err in their hearts, for they have not known my ways. Unto whom I swear in my wrath, that they should not enter into my rest. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
We say together the Jubilate Deo, Psalm 100. O be joyful in the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Be ye sure that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. O go your way into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and speak good of his name. For the Lord is gracious, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth from generation to generation. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. We say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and with thy spirit. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us, and grant us thy salvation. O Lord, save the Queen, and mercifully hear us when we call upon thee. Endue thy ministers with righteousness, and make thy chosen people joyful. O Lord, save thy people, and bless thine inheritance. Give peace in our time, O Lord, because there is none other that fighteth for us, but only thou, O God. O God, make clean our hearts within us, and take not thy Holy Spirit from us. The Collect for Peace. O God, who art the author of peace and lover of concord, in knowledge of whom standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom, defend us, thy humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defence, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Collect for Grace. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings may be ordered by thy governance, to do always that is righteous in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A prayer for the Queen. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, high and mighty, King of kings, Lord of lords, the only ruler of princes, who dost from thy throne behold all the dwellers upon earth. Most heartily we beseech thy favour to behold our most gracious sovereign lady, Queen Elizabeth, and so replenish her with the grace of thy Holy Spirit, that she may always incline to thy will and walk in thy way. Endue her plenteously with heavenly gifts, and grant her in health and wealth long to live. Strengthen her that she may vanquish and overcome all her enemies. And finally, after this life, may she attain everlasting joy and felicity.
So welcome, everybody. I've got the great pleasure of interviewing Mark today, who is really involved with our small groups. And thank you, Mark, for joining me for this little interview. Mark, tell us a little bit about your small group.
Yeah, I mean, our small group is great. I really love it. Some of us have been meeting together for several years now. But recently, particularly since lockdown, we've also got some new members as well. So I suppose on an average, we meet every week. We used to meet in people's houses, and a little bit over the summer, we did manage to meet in people's back gardens. But of course, since lockdown, we have largely been meeting on Zoom, and we meet twice a week. We meet before church, just for 20 minutes for a coffee together, like we used to when we really went to church.
Yeah.
And we also meet once a week in the evening. We used to meet for, you know, two and a half hours, but since we've been on Zoom, we've really cut that down because people have Zoom fatigue, and we probably meet for an hour maximum.
So what would a typical evening mean for you guys?
Well, we've always wanted to make it very much a social thing as well as studying God's word. So particularly when we met together in a house, we would usually crack open a bottle of wine, have some snacks, occasionally a meal together, and we'd spend the first part of the evening just chatting, talking about how our week's been, what's going on in our lives. And so consequently, we've got to know each other really well, which is amazing. I mean, all the nooks and crannies of each other's lives. And then we would usually spend a little bit of time, I say studying God's word, but mainly we haven't been very academic about it. We don't open the Bible and read a passage and then talk about it. We've done a lot of things like listening to other people's talks and then talking about them, or doing some kind of video thing. It's been quite a long time since we've sat down with a traditional Bible study guide and done that traditional thing. So we try and do things to make them a bit more fun, a bit more, I don't know, relaxing, and also so that there's not a huge amount of preparation placed on one person.
Yeah. Just tell us a bit. I mean, why do you love it so much? Why are you involved? Why do you love it?
I really love it for two reasons. First of all, I love the people, and as I say, some of us have been meeting together for a long time, and we've become very close. And you know, you talk about things with them that you wouldn't normally talk about. And I also love it because I think really, it's the main way of growing. So I mean, church is great, of course, but you know, you listen to a sermon, sometimes it washes over, sometimes it's hard to concentrate. I think where you come face to face with a small group of like-minded people and thrash things out with each other, that's when you get challenged and that's when you grow. And I think everyone in our group would say, particularly in the last couple of years, that we've all grown as individuals, but we've also grown as a group as well. So I kind of almost don't see it as a luxury thing. I think it's essential and absolutely core to us growing and moving on.
Mark, thank you so much. That's really helpful to get your insights and to hear your heart for it as well. And just thank you for your time.
Matthew 5, verses 1 to 3. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven."
It is good to be worshipping together. And this Sunday, we are beginning a new sermon series on the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes come at the start of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5. They also appear in Luke. And we, over the next few weeks, are going to be delving in line by line to work out what Jesus was saying to his original hearers and how we can apply those to our lives today. Today we are looking at, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God." But before we delve into that, I want to give a bit of a background into the Beatitudes to place them in their context so we can understand what was going on. Now, the Sermon on the Mount, as we heard read, Jesus goes on a mountainside and sits down. Sitting down was a posture of authority and teaching. And as we read, the disciples and crowds gather. Now, over the Sermon on the Mount, more and more crowds gather. We don't have time here to delve into whether it was one sermon spoken by Jesus word for word, whether it was a series of sermons, whether there was more. But the thing that we can trust is that Jesus definitely said it. And we can trust that the Holy Spirit was working within Matthew, within Luke, as they wrote their Gospels. We can trust that God was at work as the Bible was written, as Jesus spoke the very words of God. We can trust those. So what we have, we can trust. The Sermon on the Mount has parallels in the Old Testament. If we read in Deuteronomy 28, the people of God have come through the Exodus and are on the cusp of the Promised Land. They are about to enter a new era in their life. And God lists a set of blessings and a set of curses for if the people are obedient and if the people are disobedient. And in the Sermon on the Mount, similarly, we have a list of blessings and then a list of woes. As God's people, Jesus is coming to usher in a new era. The new kingdom of God is coming close. And in a moment, we'll unpack just what that kingdom means. But in Deuteronomy 28, there's a list of blessings and curses as the people of God are about to enter something new. And here in the Sermon on the Mount, there's a list of blessings and there is a list of woes as Jesus is bringing the kingdom of God near. There are also parallels in Isaiah 61, which reads, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for prisoners." And it goes on, "Comfort for those who mourn. Oil for joy instead of mourning, praise instead of despair." There's a list of things that Jesus then comes when he stands in the temple. He reads from that and declares, "This is coming now." So in the Sermon on the Mount, we have echoes of Deuteronomy 28, but we also have echoes of Isaiah 61. The kingdom of God is coming closer. But what do we mean by kingdom of God? What is that confusing phrase? The kingdom of God is where God's will is done, as we pray in the Lord's Prayer. It's where God's will is done perfectly. And God's kingdom is both past, present, and future. It's where God reigns. And so it's there from the very beginning of time. It is here now, as God's kingdom is established, and it is in the future as God's kingdom is fully established. We sometimes hear the phrase, the now and the not yet of the kingdom of God. We catch glimpses of it now, but we are not yet fully there. In God's kingdom, though, we live fully by the Spirit. And so as we work through these Beatitudes, we work out just what the kingdom of God is like. In them, the Spirit of God works within us to transform us and bring us to that fullness of the kingdom of God. The second phrase we need to unpack is blessed or blessed. What does it mean to be blessed? We might think it's to do with health, wealth, and success. Or in the Old Testament times, is victory in battle and strength for the king. But I think actually it's something different. Perhaps it's to do with happiness. Some translations, instead of blessed are those who, in the Beatitudes, we have happy are those who. Yes, to some extent it is those who, like happy is there, but happiness can be a fleeting emotion and To be blessed is to be in God's favour. If you are blessed, you are the one on whom God's favour rests. And as a result of knowing that favour, we are happy. So when we read translations of the Beatitudes, we say, happy are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. They are happy because they are blessed, because they are the ones on whom God's favour rests. So we come to today's one, today's beatitude. Blessed are the poor in spirit. What does it mean to be poor in spirit? Now, if we think we are rich, we feel that we don't need anything. In these times, I think the pandemic has shone a light on many of the things that we have put our trust in. Many of the things that we have put our security in. Over the last 6 months, we've had those foundations shaken. If we've put our foundations in health, wealth, success, family, those things have been shaken. And we've recognized, actually, we need to place our trust somewhere else. And that's true for some of us as individuals, for us locally, and I think especially nationally. Where we've put our trust and our security, we found actually if they're not in God, then we are wanting. Those who are poor in spirit recognize the complete and utter dependency on God. One author used the phrase spiritual bankruptcy. When you recognize you have nothing spiritually and you come before God with nothing. There's a wonderful hymn, Rock of Ages, which has the verse, I'll read it to you now, nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Foul I to the fountain fly, wash me, Saviour, or I die. That hymn encapsulates how we come before God. We come naked, we come empty, we come with nothing before God. If we are poor in spirit, then we acknowledge that fact. But the good news is that God's grace is undeserved, unearned, and freely given. It is when we acknowledge that we come before God with absolutely nothing that we can realize the good news of Jesus Christ, that whilst we were still sinners, Jesus Christ came to die for us, to wash us of our sins and restore our relationship with God the Father. While we were still sinners, while we had nothing, we don't deserve it, we don't earn it. And the poor in spirit recognize that fact and come before God, open, empty, and broken. So the blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. They recognize they come with nothing, but in doing so are able to receive the blessings of God, the freely given, undeserved, unearned grace of Jesus Christ. And it is in that place that the Holy Spirit can then work within us to transform us, to sanctify us, make us into Jesus' likeness. But if we think we are rich, there is no space for God's grace. When we know that we are poor, there is space for God to come and work within us. So I want to ask the question, what will be different tomorrow if we acknowledge our poorness in spirit? What will be different? Well, perhaps for some of us, we need to acknowledge for the first time that we come before God with nothing and open our arms to freely receive the gift of the grace of God, the gift of Jesus. Perhaps some of us, though, need to confess where we have put our trust and our security in other things, those places where we have felt that we are rich. in Luke 18, verse 13, there's a wonderful prayer as the tax collector humbles himself before God and says, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. It's as simple as that, coming before God and acknowledging, I've put my trust in other things, I have felt that I'm rich, but actually, God, I'm poor. I need you. I need your grace. The question might follow there, how do we depend on God? Well, I think the first place is that we can pray. Paul says to pray on all occasions, in every circumstance. And it's coming before God, going, God, I need you in my home life, in my work life, in my family life. I can't do any of these things without you, God. So will you fill me with your spirit, transform me into your likeness, wash me, Saviour, or I may die. So blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed the ones on whom God's favour rests, making them happy. The poor in spirit, those who recognise their complete and utter dependency on God and our spiritual bankruptcy. For theirs is the kingdom of God, that place where God's will is done and we are in perfect relationship with Him. So I wonder, do we need to confess before God where we have put our trust in other things? Is it time for us to come before God humbly and go, God, I need you? And then spend the rest of this day and this week coming before God regularly. God, I need you in this situation, in this circumstance, for I have nothing else. Let's pray. Almighty God, our Father, we acknowledge that we come before you with nothing. We thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ, our undeserved, unearned gift of grace, that he died on the cross for us whilst we were still sinners. We thank you that by his death we can have perfect relationship with you. And while we live in the now and the not yet of the kingdom of God, we pray that we may see glimpses of your kingdom breaking through today and this week. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Of ages cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin the double cure. Save from wrath and make me the labor of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? These for sin could not atone. Thou must save and thou alone. Simply to thy cross I cling, naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Foul I to the fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die. Wash me, Savior, or I die. I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I rise to worlds unknown and behold thee on thy throne. Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself, let me hide myself, let me hide myself in thee. Let me hide myself, let me hide myself, let me hide myself in thee. Let me hide myself, let me hide, let me hide myself in thee.
Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen. The final blessing. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you all and all those for whom you pray, now and forevermore. Amen.